Thank you. I invite you at this time to please rise as you're able and join in singing our opening hymn number 779 that can be found in your reddish hymnal in front of you, the large numbers toward the back of the book, the top of the page, number 779. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered here this day to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our brother Don, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I invite you to join me in prayer. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Don. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope, until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I invite you to be seated at this time for our reflections.
Good morning. My name is Hunter Berg. I had the pleasure of playing for Mr. Overbo what seems like a long, long time ago, and yet it some days feels like just yesterday. I always worry about speaking, especially when I have to speak either before or after someone. Mark called the other day, asked if I'd speak. Of course, I said I'd be honored to. He asked if I'd tell a few stories. I said, Mark, I'm not a storyteller, but I think I can speak from my heart on this one. Then I met Skip Espeseth more than I've met him before last night, and I knew I was in big trouble if we were comparing storytelling. So I think graciously we made a wise decision that I would go first and he would go second. So Skip, I wish either I was a little bit older or you were a little bit younger. You seem like you would have been a lot of fun to hang out with back in the day. I'm here speaking today because about 35 years ago there was a group of young kids in the Gunnor area that grew up loving sports. We dreamed of playing for the Gunnora Gophers someday. There was a pretty good group of athletes at that time in Gunnora, and we wanted to be like them, play like them, wear the maroon and gold. But what we didn't realize was that most of our athletic dreams would come to be realized not because of those players that came before us that we were watching, but because we ended up with our dream coach in Mr. Overbo. And fast forwarding a few years from there, 27 years ago, this very month, Mr. Overbo coached us in our dream season. For as confused as we were as to why he retired from coaching our basketball team, we were absolutely elated that he was going to coach our football team. We enjoyed every Monday practice, watching him walk across the parking lot onto the field, gather us and look at us with a devilish sly grin and say, I've done some thinking this weekend, and I have got some good plays for us to learn this week. We marveled at the pile upon pile of X's and O's scribbled on napkins, scratch paper, notepads, you name it. He was a true master of the craft of drafting plans, offensive and defensive strategies to make our team better. At times, Mr. Overbo was as tough as nails. In fact, I think some would say actually a little bit mean at times. On the other hand, he could be as kind and as gentle as you would find. He expected perfection in practice and yet could laugh at a simple, comical mistake. He was as competitive as anybody I've ever met and yet was gracious and professional in a loss. He was very staunch in the fundamentals of the game and yet creative and adaptive in letting his players be players and do what they did best. He was liked by many, I'm sure not liked by just as many, but that is coaching. One thing was for certain, few teams were better prepared. In studying the legendary John Wooden's legacy during my own coaching career, I learned that Wooden thought his most important job was to get his team ready to its optimal level before the game started. He believed he should be able to walk up into the stands, watch the game, and not say a word. And that was Mr. Overbo. It's tough to recall really a handful of times when an in-game adjustment of any major kind had to be made. The game plan, the preparedness of our team was always right on. Later in life, I enjoyed when he'd stop by the office just to visit. Undoubtedly, the first thing I'd hear was the latest pinochle victory. Or if it didn't go his way, come to think of it, it was usually a teammate's fault for not passing the right cards or not playing the right cards at the right time. I just hate to lose, he'd always tell me. And I always said, I know you do, Mr. Overbo, but sometimes can't you feel good that the other team feels good for winning? He never agreed with me on that statement. I remember one particularly hot summer day. He stopped by on his way through town. We did our normal visiting, and I finally asked Mr. Overbrow, well, where's Arlene? He got me cracking up hysterically when he very seriously answered me, oh, Arlene's out in the car, but don't worry. I parked in the shade with the windows down. Arlene, thank you for being so supportive and allowing all of us to be a part of yours and Mr. Overbow's life. I know being a coach's wife is not easy, but we know how patient you were, and we owe you many thanks. When Mark did call me, I reluctantly told him that, you know, for the last at least 2 years, I told myself, I've got to get up there and see Mr. Overbow. Our visits had become more infrequent, and sadly, I just didn't take the time. Many times I had gone over in my mind what I would try to say. I know if I had made it up to see him, I would have been greeted with a warm smile and a handshake. He would have asked me how my family was doing. We would have talked about old teammates and caught up on where they are all at. And I know I probably would have fumbled it. But I just wanted a chance to sincerely thank him for all the many things he did for us, sometimes knowingly, but often unknowingly. I would have thanked him for teaching us that the smallest details need to be practiced and practiced well. Every screen, every block, every handoff, perfectly executed. I would have thanked him for teaching us the value of sportsmanship and respect for the game. There's no need for showboating and no need for taunting. And I think we need that back today. I would have thanked him for working so hard to try and maximize our athletic talents while at the same time holding us to a high standard of behaving like a gentleman. Once in a while, self-admittedly, our group still gets together. And undoubtedly, we end up talking about the glory days. And for us, it's really fun to talk about that season and all the special moments that went into it. But as much as we talk about a play on the field, we always talk about Mr. Overbow, his genius, and how much he contributed to our success. He'd always say he didn't do much, but we know better. I would have thanked him for truly helping us create such wonderful, wonderful memories and those glory days. I've rambled on and on about Mr. Overbow as a coach, and I know he was much more than a coach. But for us, the thankfulness that we have that he was our coach can never be diminished. In closing, one of the last, long-lasting lessons Mr. Overbow taught us, and I will carry forever, is that, especially after a tough loss, he'd always tell us, the sun will come up tomorrow. May not feel like it, but it will come up tomorrow. He was always right. And I suppose he always will be. It will come up tomorrow. I'm just thankful we had many days and many great times together with Mr. Overbow under that glorious sun. We were truly blessed that we could call him coach.
Good morning. Skip Espeseth, Noonan Miners, class of 76. Overbow family, what an absolute honor. And privilege to be asked to give the eulogy at Mr. Overbow's funeral. He touched the lives of many people. And to be able to share my memories and the memories of many others will be something I will treasure forever. As shown by the attendance here today and the outpouring of condolences from literally around the country, Mr. Overbow was truly a remarkable man. This has been a very emotional time for all of us, and I'm sure you can tell I am quite nervous. However, I may have picked up a thing or two from Mr. Overbull. So if I have a little cough or a little twitch in my neck, you will know why. Many remember Mr. Overbull as the basketball coach, but he was also a great teacher in the classroom. For those of you that follow social media, check out the Noonan High School Friends page on Facebook. At last count, there were 213 members on this site, and the Overbull stories posted there have been viewed by 173 of those 213 people. And what is more impressive to me are the stories and testimonials from non-athletes that said he was the best teacher they ever had, or how he had a huge effect on their lives and still do today. And I wonder how many letters of recommendation he wrote for former students who are trying to get into a university or graduate school or some type of job. Linda Hishlin Anderson recalls a story from typing class where she was admittedly the worst typer in the class. One day, Mr. Overbull was so frustrated with her, he tried to get her to stop attempting to type by putting the typewriter cover on her head. Many others commented on what a great bookkeeping teacher he was. Many of us weren't great fans of numbers, but he was able to explain things in a way that we could all understand. And I know of a few students that went on to careers in accounting because of the influence Mr. Overbull had on them. He also was able to weave sports into almost every lesson. Big surprise, right? I heard from numerous sources on game day classes they would begin with, "Did you all get your homework done? Any questions? Okay, girls, you can sit over there and talk about whatever you want. Boys, gather around." And they would discuss game preparation for that night's football or basketball game. They would discuss strategies, tendencies, and maybe even draw a play or two up on the chalkboard. The day after the game, the process was the same. Any questions on your bookkeeping homework? No? Okay, good. Let's talk about the game. And the post-game analysis would begin. For myself, it's a wonder I ever got my schoolwork done, as I never had a real study hall from September through February. Virtually every day, Mr. Overbull would come in study hall, ask us if I was busy. Of course, I would say no. And we would retreat back into his office to talk basketball and football. We discussed plays, strategies, practice schedules, and everything else under the sun, and I treasure those conversations. Mr. Overbull came to Noonan in the fall of 1968. Those were the olden days when the score clock in the gym in Noonan would turn red for the last minute of the quarter. Short hair was required, and Mr. Overbull made sure Morris, the barber up here in Crosby, was kept busy as he sent a steady group of customers up there each week. The players had to dress up for games and were absolutely forbidden to sit with their girlfriend before the game. It is my understanding that Randy Hishlin and Jim Ronholt were the recipients of a few discussions regarding this rule. People in the area knew of the Overbull family and Don, but I think his coming out party was the Burke County Boys Basketball Tournament that first year. At that time, there was an overwhelming number of teams that had big guys. Sherwood went 6'8", 6'7", 6'5". Powers Lake had Kurt Holman at 6'7". Bobel's Bob Ness at 6'6", Mick McIntyre at 6'3". Columbus had big size, Don Dealey, Steve Brattling, Jim Iverson, and a few others. What did Noonan have? Four admittedly short, slow guys, and big Jim Ronholt, who topped out at a whopping 6 feet tall. But at the Burke County Tournament that year, they defeated Bobels in the first game and upset Columbus in the semifinals, but were eventually defeated by Burke Central in the championship. But I think people in the area took notice and said, hey, we better watch out. Noonan's got a coach who will bring a competitive team to play each night. I've talked to numerous coaches over the years, and many said that they enjoyed playing Noonan the best of any team as an opponent because they knew the Miners would be competitive and hardworking, and that Coach Overwell would have something up his sleeve. Speaking of Jim Ronholt, he says he can still hear Coach Overbowl yelling out, Ronholt! As he was running down the floor. And it was later revealed by Mrs. Overbowl that Coach would even yell out Ronholt's name in his sleep. Coach Overbowl was able to get the maximum output from each player, no matter what their physical abilities were. He demanded respect and 100% dedication and commitment from each and every player on each and every day. Once you stepped out on that floor or on that field, you were expected to give your all. And if you didn't, you got pulled aside for a one-sided conversation and your intensity turned back up. But Coach Overbowl had a way of chewing you out, making you mad, but by the end of the discussion, you were ready to run through another wall for him. I honestly don't remember getting yelled at very much, but I will never forget the stare. He would stand up, put his hands on his hips, and give you the look that said you better straighten up or else. I actually used that tactic in my short teaching and coaching career, as well as my parenting skills, and it worked really well. Mr. Overbowl was a master of the mental part of the game. He knew how to get the most out of every player. He admitted he did not treat us all the same, except that he did what he thought was needed to get us to use the talents that God gave us. Some players responded to praise, others to, we'll call it encouragement. But he had a knack of knowing what to do to whom. And then he would say something like, it's nothing personal. I'm just trying to make you a better ball player. Coach Overbowl was always looking to gain whatever psychological advantage he could. When I was a sophomore, we had another giant team, and I actually played center for half the year until our two big guys, Lenny Lukacs and Bob Anseth, who topped out at 6 feet each, were ready to play. We went down to Tioga. They went 6'6", 6'5", 6'3", and had good guards. Anyway, we played them straight up. Dwight Barden hits a jump shot at the buzzer. We beat him 61-59. When they came up to Noonan, we knew the Pirates would be looking for revenge and that we'd never beat them straight up again. So we did the old Noonan stall. Everybody hated the Noonan stall. And I don't know if it ever worked, but it sure made teams prepare for us. Anyway, back in those days, the home team got to decide at which basket to warm up at before the game. So we sat in the locker room until the visiting team, Tioga, went out on the floor. Then we went out on the floor and made them go to the other end to warm up. Boy, were their players and coaches and fans mad. The stall worked for a while, but they eventually whacked us pretty good. The point is that Coach Overwell was trying to find any advantage that he could. Coach Overwell was also a believer in scouting, not only opponents, but upcoming players at Noonan. When I was a seventh grader, I went out for football and I wanted to play center. I wanted to be a lineman. After the second practice, varsity coach Overbow came to me and said, "You are not going to be a center. You are a quarterback." And that was luckily the end of me playing in the line. And I actually got in a varsity game as an eighth grader out in Granora. And we actually won quite handily. Sorry, Hunter. One of the greatest coaching seasons that Mr. Overboy ever had was the football team in the fall of 1974. We had a grand total of 17 guys, if everybody showed up. We obviously didn't have enough even to scrimmage, so we would practice all the plays to the left side with the guys on the right side playing defense, and then we'd switch around. Our linebackers averaged 150 pounds, and we had one guy that weighed 200 pounds. Thank you, Gary Spooner. We cruised through the regular season and won the Souris River Valley West Conference and then played Deluxe Burlington, who had won the East. We were warming up out on the field, all 17 of us, when the DLB buses showed up. Yes, I said buses, plural. The players started coming off the bus, and I swear there was at least 100 of them. They ran their lap around the field, and if they'd have joined hands, they'd have made a circle around Vornis Field. We kicked off to them. They immediately marched down the field, scored a touchdown. We thought, man, this is going to be a long night. But we stopped them on the extra point. Coach Overbow made a couple of adjustments, and we went on to dominate the game. We only won 14-6. But we probably had three times as many yards as they did. One of the stories that few people know is that in preparation for that game, Deluxe Burlington went up to Berthold to practice under the lights. Legend has it that an unnamed person from Berthold happened to be around during that practice and called Coach Overbow with a little scouting report. And I have talked over the years to many coaches and administrators that were in and around Berthold at that time, and I have yet to find one that will admit or let me know who made that call. I could go on and on with these stories, but it would be just like the end of football practice. We'd practice in the yard just east of the school in Noonan and would often hear the 6 o'clock p.m. Town whistle, which we knew meant that practice was getting close to being done. But Coach Overbow hated to end practice on a down note, and he would say, just one more play. And we knew that meant 15 or 20 more minutes. Coach Overbow mellowed, and I'm not sure that's the right word, but it's the best one that I could come up with over the years. He was a stickler for details and a strict disciplinarian, yet he gave us some freedom. I can remember teams like Divide County and Partial had to dress up for basketball games, and they'd come in colored blazers and white turtlenecks, dress pants, and church shoes. We eventually didn't have to dress up for games, and our team uniform was blue jeans and flannel shirts. He also picked out leaders and let them have freedom. At least one year, the team captains in football got to decide how many sprints to run at the end of practice. He let us determine how much conditioning we need to do, And I'm thinking we probably ran more than if he would have been in charge. I also remember a couple of his favorite phrases. Practice makes permanent. His rationale in changing the end of that popular phrase was that if you practice something wrong, it didn't make it perfect, it made it permanent. Also, good sermon, poor benediction, which meant there was a great play or some great move, but you ended up missing the shot or being unsuccessful. He stressed completing whatever you do. I guess nowadays they call it finishing. Mr. Overwell was concerned about all of us, from the basketball players to the cheerleaders to the stats to that last kid sitting at the back of the study hall. He wanted us all to succeed. Oh, there's the neck thing. He wanted us to use the talent that God gave us to make us better ball players, better students, better citizens, and I think he did that. To the Overwell family, again, thank you for the opportunity to meander down memory lane. Mr. Overwell was truly one of the great guys in the world.
Thank you both for sharing. Our first reading today comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and over all the wild animals of the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." Our second reading for today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 23 through 27. The Apostle Paul writes, "I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race the runners all compete, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win it. Athletes exercise self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable one. So I do not run aimlessly, nor do I box as though beating the air, but I punish my body and enslave it, so that after proclaiming to others, I myself should not be disqualified." Our gospel this day comes from John, the 14th chapter. I invite you to rise as you so desire. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. I invite you to be seated at this time. So we heard in our reading from Genesis that every human is created in the image of God. Therefore, it's safe to say that Don was created in God's image. Don was a man who was passionate about his family, about his friends, about his students, and about sports. And I can see how God's image of love has shone forth in Don's passions, leading him to be one who loved his family deeply and his friends deeply, and shared his love of sports with others and inspired them. I can also see God's image when I look at Don's coaching career, as one who continually encouraged and instructed young athletes to work hard, to become more than they once were. This too is God's hope for humanity, to encourage and instruct us so that we can become more, so that we will love deeper, so that we will build fuller and deeper relationships. Now, as I just heard, it was Don's tradition to teach by using sports, so I'm going to try it today, all right? So we heard about athletes from the Apostle Paul in our reading from 1 Corinthians. We heard, "Do you not know that in a race the runners all compete, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win it." I think Don would really appreciate this piece of scripture. If you're going to play a sport, you should put in the effort to improve yourself so that you can have a chance of victory. Do everything in your power to succeed. As we heard, Don applied this in how he coached. Not only that, but Don applied this in his own life. I hear his golf game was one that he practiced at home, in his yard, in the garage, on the course. I also heard that because of his dedication to the sport, not too long ago, I didn't get a particular time, but not very long ago, he went out and golfed 2 holes. And he birdied the first hole and he parred the second hole. Wow. This is what practice is about. Practice makes permanent. Repeatedly working on areas that need growth so that victory is attainable. Run in such a way that you may win. The Apostle Paul uses sports to help us understand how we are called to live as Christians. He goes on to write, "Athletes exercise self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath." This is what you received at the time, not a trophy, but a laurel leaf wreath. "They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable one." Paul writes concerning how athletes compete for a prize that will ultimately fade away. We as Christians should live our lives in such a way to receive the prize of everlasting life from God, the prize that will last forever. So as Christians, we are called to practice, so that these things become permanent, so that loving God and loving other people comes naturally, so that we do this every day, so this becomes normal for us, so that loving one another becomes as natural as a basketball player dribbling a ball or a baseball player throwing and catching a baseball. We are called to exercise and practice living how God calls us to live, building loving relationship with God and with other people. In the same way as Don pursued sports, I believe Don pursued his life of faith. He lived in such a way that those around him knew that he loved them. He made it a point to spend time with others, to share life with them, to offer wisdom if needed, to genuinely care about other people. We are called to practice living our lives in a way that lets others know that God loves them and that we love them too. Jesus is as passionate about this calling to love as Don was passionate about sports. We are invited into relationship with God in such a way that God, like a good coach, pushes us to love more, to achieve things we never thought possible, to become more than we once were. This is God's hope for you and for the world, that we would practice loving others and continually growing stronger in love for one another. For practice makes perfect. permanent. And yet, there's also an important message I need you to hear. God does not push us to love because somehow you need to be better in order for God to love you. Not at all. God's love for you and for Don is solid and secure, never changing, never ending. This was proven to the world on the cross as Jesus died, demonstrating the love that God has for you. That God would rather die than lose relationship with you, or lose relationship with Don. No, the reason that God pushes us to love better, to practice and become stronger in our love for one another, is for a simple reason: making sure others know that they are valued by God. By making sure we have more teammates, so we're not at a loss, 17 players. So that we can continue to grow God's kingdom in the world and invite others into this life of love. And if we make sure others know they are valued, there's finally a chance for them to know that if I let them know they matter to me, there's a chance that they can know that they matter to God even more. And this is God's great push, that all would know of God's love and be transformed by God's love, that all would live together in peace and love, working to make sure all people are cared for. This is God's ultimate goal: to bring all people to live together with God without tears and without grief, without pain. This is what is promised to us today in our reading from John. We heard Jesus say, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." Jesus promises that he will not forget Don. He will not forget you. Jesus promises that he will prepare a place for you, and that he has prepared a place for Don. And if we consider it, Don's place probably has lots of areas to practice golf, maybe even a radio to keep, you know, in tune with the Cubs. What's going on there? Who knows? What we do know is that God's love is for Don, both now and forever. And we know that God's love is for you, both now and forever. So in these next days and weeks, months and years, life will be different without Don. We cannot stop in to visit him. We won't see him around town. We won't see him out on the golf course. We cannot hear his stories. He will not give us any more grief. Life is now different. In this time, as we learn how to navigate life without Don, it is important for us to remember God's love and how God calls us to love one another. This is a perfect time for us to practice loving one another, giving each other grace, being a listening ear to those who are grieving, building loving relationship with one another. I encourage you to practice this love as Don would, so that practice becomes permanent. May you come to know God's love for you more and more each day. Amen. I was asked to sing a song by the family, but they didn't tell me a song, so I picked one. And it's maybe not the most well-known song. Well, this is a song about death and grief. And that grief is experienced differently by every person. And it's dealt with individually. But in the midst of grief, we are called to be supportive of one another, to remember that we're not alone in this grief. If you look around here, there are plenty of people who know Don and love Don. And I invite you to look around really quickly, if that's all right. take note of these people and to remember that we are called to be there for one another. We are called to love one another and care for one another in this time. And also to remember that even when you don't have friends around you, that Jesus promises to be with you always. So this is a song called Timshel by Mumford & Sons. Cold is the water, it freezes your already cold mind, your already cold, cold mind. And death is at your doorstep, and it will steal your innocence, but it will not steal your substance. But you are not alone in this, and you are not alone in this. As brothers, we will stand and we'll hold your hand, we'll hold your hand. And you are the mother, mother of your baby child, the one to whom you gave life. And you have your choices, and these are what make man great, his ladder to the stars. You are not alone in this. You are not alone in this. As brothers, we will stand and we'll hold your hand. We'll hold your hand. And I will tell the I invite you at this time to please rise as you so desire. And join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to join me in prayer. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us who are still in our journey and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Just a quick announcement at this time. Following the service, we're going to be heading right out to the cemetery. Those of you who would like to join are welcome to do so. Those of you who would rather not, that's just fine. The family would like for you to know that you can head downstairs and start eating food. So in light of that, I invite you to join me in singing the table blessing. It's on the back side of your insert. Let's pray. Be present at our table, Lord. Be here and everywhere adored. These mercies bless and grant that we may feast in paradise with thee. Amen. Let us commend Don to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Don. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. I invite you to join in singing our recessional song. It's in your red hymnal once again, number 785.